tell me a little bit about what you do and how's your journey been in entrepreneurship so far?
Starting out, my name is Juan Miguel Gonzalez. I'm 21. I'm a Houston realtor. Right now, I'm focusing on e-commerce. I have that as a side business, as well as real estate investing with my parents.
Well, what exactly do you do in terms of real estate, and how did you get started? And also, how long did it take you to get your license?
So starting out, I was going to school. I was studying kinesiology, getting my degree. Mm-hmm. I started reading some entrepreneurship books, learning about financial freedom. You know, I started out with the Rich Dad, Poor Dad.
Yeah.
And from there, I started getting the mentality of financial freedom, financial independence. Mm-hmm. And I started thinking about learning how to invest, learning how to day trade, doing stocks with my boy, Beatty. And that's how we got in contact. But for me, I decided to take a leap of faith, took a gap semester, I got my real estate license. It took me a month to study for my courses, and then it took me a month to study for my exam, and I was able to pass it on the second try. After that, I was able to start, find my brokerage, and join. I've been working as a realtor now for 6 months, and love every step of the way.
Amazing, bro. That's good to hear. So, man, so you tell me that it took you a long time to get your license and everything, right?
Yeah.
Man, like, the thing is like, you know, the point of this podcast is to kind of open the minds of people that are like coming straight out of college or coming straight out of high school, shit. And they're kind of like lost, and they're kind of like, oh, yo, what do I do? Where do I go? But like, let me ask you this, bro. Did you have any guidance in the beginning? Like, did you know exactly what you were going to be doing? Or were you kind of like lost and kind of like, yo, like, which path do I take?
Right.
Like, how did you know real estate was going to be the one?
Ultimately, during high school, I always wanted to help people, and I kind of focused myself towards physical therapy because I broke my ankle before COVID, actually. And so I had surgery, and I had to get my physical therapy as well. Broke my ankle back in 2020 before COVID. And unfortunately, I had to go to physical therapy myself. So I kind of took the physical therapy track, thinking that that's what I was going to do right after high school. Go to school, get my kinesiology degree, and go to physical therapy school. Mm-hmm. However, my mom, love my mom, she had a contact with someone from church who was a realtor himself, who's been working as a realtor and has his own brokerage for 20 years. And he let me do a ride-along with him. He told me 4 books that I should buy. He said, you got to start with Rich Dad, Poor Dad, Richest Man of Babylon, Cash Flow Quadrant, and What Every Real Estate Investor Needs to Know Before Investing.
Yeah.
So after reading those 4 books, it allowed me to think about financial freedom. What does that mean? Mm-hmm. It allowed me to learn about investing, learn about trading.
After the guy gave you the advice saying, hey, these are the 4 books you should read. Mm-hmm. This is what you should do. How did you kind of go from there to pivot into, you know, saying, you know what, I'm gonna go 100% into real estate, and I'm gonna just gun it? Or like, did it kind of just fall into place? Because I mean, you know, that sometimes that does happen, where like you just like don't even think about it, you just get started, and then things start to fall in place. Is that kind of what happened, or did you kind of have to force yourself to do it even though you kind of didn't like it? Tell me like the process that you kind of that took you to the next level of like getting things in line, going with the flow, you know? Because me, I did my real estate license too. A lot of them don't know this.
Oh, really?
But yeah.
Yeah,
but the thing is I got all 6 courses. I passed all the classes, and the test came. And I started talking to all these real estate agents. I was like, oh, fuck, I can't really take a test. I'm not good at test taking, you know?
Yeah.
So that kind of just like stopped me a little bit, and I stopped right there. Like, that was my end of my real estate journey, you know? But I still like real estate. I still like houses. I still want to invest. I have a couple of properties I'm trying to get into, like a duplex and a fourplex as well. But the main thing was that for me, that was the end of my journey. I was like, you know what? Test taking, doing things like traditionally, is just not my thing. I just couldn't do it, you know?
I got you.
So like, that's my question to you, is like, how did you just get the ball rolling?
Using that connection from the church, I was able to ask him as a mentor. Mm-hmm. And so he was my guidance in the beginning. Mm-hmm. After I got my license, he showed me the path of investing. And so for me, I was able to find an investment group that now I brought my dad in, and we have created our own LLC, and we created that about a month ago.
Oh.
And so now we're starting wholesaling as well as rehabbing, and buy and holds.
Oh.
So that's where our real estate investing journey has begun. My real estate journey started back in January,
I remember, after
I got my license. Right. But
how's the wholesaling thing going? Did you guys just start?
Yeah, we just started. So we were able to create a script. We have done some cold calls before, and we're getting the ball rolling. We have one deal in the pipeline right now.
Oh wow!
Pipeline means in the works.
Yeah, I remember that. Sales thing.
But bunch of technical terms.
For your property, how exactly you're finding your properties? How are you looking for them? Are you doing like water shut off? Are you doing pre-foreclosures? Because I've been wholesaling before as well, so I kind of have an idea of them. What are you doing right now in today's 2023 day and age doing to find these leads for these wholesale deals?
Good question. So right now I have some contacts. I have some realtors that have off-market properties.
Ooh.
That's where you're going to get the majority of your business. It's going to be through your contacts, your networks, and it's all going to be off-market.
That's crazy.
Now looking online, it would be pre-foreclosure as well as subject to and short sale. Short sales are big.
Right now, especially right now, 2023, what is it? July.
Uh-huh.
Right. July of 2023. Hey, I know that I'm speaking into the future, but the real estate market is going to be fucked.
Yeah, yeah.
Like it's slowly starting to come down. And for me, I'm looking at it from the point of economics. I see that the interest rates just went to 5.50 year over year. So when it was at like 4.5, it was already going down. But imagine now, think about like in 1 or 2 months from now, like it's going to get really bad. People are going to default on their loans. And then you have all these real estate guys doing short sales. And then, you know, next thing you know, I don't know what's going to happen because you have Biden, you have the elections next year. Yep. So it's kind of like you don't really know what's going to happen. Because wholesaling, what it is like pretty much you find a distressed property, right? Mm-hmm. You buy it in cash and you connect that property to an investor, right? So, but the thing is I think what you're doing is you're probably putting some money into the property once you find it, right?
Uh-huh.
You're going to find the property, the distressed property, getting it under contract, buying it, selling it, or are you investing in it or flipping it and investing into it?
If there's a if there's an owner that has a house and they're trying to sell it fast, what I do as a wholesaler is I call them, I get in contact with them, I do my own numbers, okay, this is how much it is to flip. And it's called the ARV, after repair value.
Mm-hmm.
So if I like the house, there's a house, I want to put 500 to 1,000 down. It could be less than that. And this is what you call it for your option period. And you buy the contract. This means that it's under your name. So now this contract, it takes about 30 days to close. So this contract, I have 30 days to find a cash buyer. And so this is where I work with my investors. I have my cash buyer list. So with this contract, I get in contact with, say, Ubaidi. He has enough money to buy this $150,000 home, right? So if he gets this $150,000 home and I sell it to him,
mm-hmm.
and I assign it, that's the word, assign the contract mm-hmm. to him, he can buy that property and I get a percentage of that money to
you. Get the assignment fee, right?
I get
right?
the assignment fee. Mm-hmm. And that could range between, you know, 20 to 30,000, 50,000. It just all depends on what you work
numbers,
with the investor.
Like if the deal makes sense, I think it's 70-75%, right?
It could be.
Yeah,
it could
yeah.
be. It
around
depends.
That, yeah.
yeah.
Okay, well, there you go. I mean, you see, that's the thing. Well, wow, that's what I was doing. I was just, all I was doing was cold calling a bunch of, probate properties.
Okay.
You know, yeah. probate, like people probate, that just yeah. died. Yeah, it's good, but like at the same time, sometimes those people, they already have their own thing going on, you know? Like,
yeah, they're not
because,
worried about that.
Yeah, they're not worried. Sometimes they want to live in the house, like they don't really want to sell it.
Yeah.
But yeah, pretty much it's just finding distressed properties. And the reason why it's so easy is because they're motivated sellers, bro. Like, it depends on who you're targeting, of course, but they're motivated sellers. Like, if you go to a probate, you go to a divorce, bro, if you tell them I have $180,000 in cash I'll give to you right now for your one bed, one bath, they'll take it, bro. Like, it's like a no-brainer, you know? Like,
yeah, exactly.
You're coming to me with cash. Why wouldn't I take it, you know? So yeah, anyways, I really hope the best for you in that business because it's about to get hot, you know, like, so you, like, it's a good time to get in. And that's why me as well, I'm trying to look at like some kind of multifamily, like smaller, affordable living, you know,
okay.
But that's another project for the future.
Got you.
Yeah.
And then I also wanted to tell you, so when it comes to loans, the misconception of, oh, I have to put 20% down or I need a certain, like I need 50,000 in order for me to buy a home.
Yeah.
if you are looking to invest, looking to buy a first rental property, it's not true. So what do I mean by it's not true is that there are so many loans. If you can call your local credit union, if you call big banks like Chase, Wells Fargo, or even different brokerages, they can give you loans. And the ones that you want to look for is called the DCR loan. The DCR loan is debt coverage ratio loan. And basically what this loan is, instead of looking at your credit score, looking at your W-2s for 2 years, if you have an income job, what they do is they look at the rental income of the property first before you. So what does this mean? So say that I'm a realtor, I get paid as a W-9. I'm an independent contractor. That means I don't have a W-2. These are just two different IRS tax forms that you get from the IRS when you claim your income. Does that make sense? And so me being a W-9, I can't get certain loans because I don't have the W-2 form. So with this DCR loan, I'm able to find a rental income. They look at the property. If this rental income makes enough money, they'll supply the loan. Now, what do I have to have? I have to have a certain amount of money. Doesn't have to be 20%. It could be less than 20% down, and a good credit score. But they don't look at my W-9 per se. So, so when it comes to loans, there's money out there, and you can definitely start investing with little to no money. Other ways are investment groups, hard money, private money. Although the interest rate is higher, it's still money that allows you to get that property.
OPM
allows you to exactly be investing. And so there's many other routes as well, but I just wanted to say that.
Bro, so that shit right there is game for me. So for like entrepreneurs, business owners, e-commerce owners, agency owners, all these people that have kind of LLC money or sole proprietorship money, right? You're saying that this is the way to go. And if you were to pretty much summarize, was it DSC?
DCR.
If you can summarize a DCR loan in one or two sentences, how would you summarize it?
So a DCR loan, it looks at the rental income of the property before it looks at you. Uh-huh. So a DCR loan looks at the rental income property, and then it looks at you. Normal loans look at you before you can get approved for a loan, and they don't look at the property.
Wow.
That's the difference.
Wow. So it's like if you want to invest, that's the way to go, right?
That's the way to go.
And especially to start out. Yeah, especially if you're like a entrepreneur, right? Because like I know that people with jobs, I mean, I'd say it's a little bit easier for them because they can just say, hey, take my monthly paycheck, my bills, bank statements, whatever the fuck. Like, right. So easy, you know?
Right.
But for entrepreneurs, sometimes their income is inconsistent. One month they'll make 100 grand, exactly. And the other month they'll make 10 grand. You know what I mean? So it's like, it's hard to kind of prove. And that was my problem, you know? Right. Like one month I was negative 4,000, right? In profits is one of my worst months. And then the next month I came up 20 grand. I made 20 grand. So it's like, it kind of covered the income for like 3 to 4 months, you know what I mean?
Gotcha. Yeah.
So that's I was kind of like, you know what, I'm never going to be able to have a consistent, you know. But what I started doing for traders out there, I opened up an LLC and I started withdrawing exactly 3,000. I know it's not a lot, but 3,000 a month, right? I mean, for me, I'm 21. My living is not that expensive. I take out 3,000 a month, be minimal. Because the thing is, when trading is, you have to keep the money in your account, right? Like, that's capital that you're using every day to trade.
Right.
And the more you take from that, the less money you have to trade, you know, and the smaller the profits you'll have, right?
That's true.
So yeah, so you kind of just got to prove income that way. It's like you kind of take 3,000 a month, you put it in the bank account every single month, boom, 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 until it hits 2 years. You need 2 years. Once 2 years hit, you pay your taxes, blah, blah, blah. And then you can apply for a loan and, you know, like the traditional way.
Exactly.
So if you want to cut all that bullshit out, pretty much go with that loan that he was talking about, and it'll cut you a learning curve. I'm coming right out of college.
Okay.
I want to know if it's a good idea to get a FHA loan or if I should get a regular loan. What do you think is the best option for me to do and how easy it is? What are the requirements to get an FHA loan?
It's called house hacking.
Oh.
House hacking is a big thing coming out of college that you could use. It's what is house hacking, Juan? So house hacking is basically owning a home. You can use a conventional loan. And with that house hacking, you are allowed to basically rent out the home and you want to see if you can live in the home. How does that work? So you find a tenant that will pay your monthly payment as well as allow you to live in the home that you already own. How do you do that? Well, family, friends, roommates. You can find a deal and you can even make a little contract between your tenant and you in order for you to live at the house during the year period or however long that you have that contract for. But this is a way for you to save money as well as get your house payment down as well as living in a home. Now going back to your question, I always give, and that's how house hacking is. Now going back to your question about FHA. FHA, you can find the specifics talking to a lender or your local bank or your local credit union. But it's basically a good background check, credit score, as well as your monthly income. And it's W-2. FHA, what FHA is you can put 3.5% down up front, which is very beneficial when you're trying to get your own home. But the monthly payments are going to be a little bit more than a normal conventional loan. Conventional loans can range from 5, 10, 15, 20% down. You just kind of have to have a higher interest rate if you go for the lower payment, down payment. Mm-hmm. But at the end of the day, you work with your lender and you see what loan best suits you.
Nice, bro. So tell me a little bit about so basically what you said is it's better to get an FHA loan if you don't have the money pretty much to really go with the full loan, which kind of makes sense. I mean, you know, because 3.5% of like a $100,000 house is only what, $3,000, right?
Yeah. $3,000.
But I'm not saying a house is going to be $100,000. I'm just, you know, giving an example. But yeah, so pretty much, so tell me, if I wanted to get into investing now, uh-huh, right? And I already bought my own house. I've already used the FHA loan. Now, like, what's the best way to get into buying my first duplex? Or you said house hacking, right? That's one of the ways you can get in.
Yep.
What if I want to kind of get some capital? Is there a, like a hustle, like, I've heard of wholesaling. I don't know if you've heard of that too.
Yep.
Is that a way to kind of get some quick cash up the ground and then use that money to invest in properties? Or tell me some other strategies that you have.
So right, what I'm doing now is part-time e-commerce, part-time wholesaling, as well as full-time real estate agent. I don't know how that works, but that's what I'm doing. So wholesaling, it's a side hustle that me and my dad do with our investing LLC that we created. E-commerce allows me to get a little bit monthly income coming in every day. And my main focus is real estate. I'm an agent. What I recommend going into your first investment property would be, like I said, work with the lenders and look for conventional loans that best suit you. But I recommend the DCR loan. That's the debt coverage ratio loan.
Ooh.
And basically,
what is that?
Yeah, so the DCR loan is it looks at your rental income of the property. Most loans, they qualify you first. Mm-hmm. But this loan qualifies the property first, mm-hmm, and then you have to have some sort of capital in your bank. But it doesn't have to be 15, 20% down. It can range.
Do you have to have a good credit score?
You have to have a good credit score.
Like a good or like a decent?
That's specific. It could be 650,
right?
680.
Yeah.
It depends on the lender.
Yeah, okay.
Basically, the credit score tells the lender that, okay, you can.
You're trustworthy, yeah.
Basically, what the credit score tells the lender is that you're trustworthy, you can pay the loan back.
Yeah. Brooke, I like that idea, that concept more because, like, you don't necessarily have to have the income, but you have to have the cash.
Right.
And that's the case for a lot of entrepreneurs. They have the cash, mm-hmm, they have the money to get in, they can prove that they're getting money. But they don't have those,
W-2, and that's the main thing for entrepreneurs, right?
That's the problem that we deal with, yeah.
Yes.
So, like, what I used to do before, like, I just recently started an LLC, like, this is very, very recent. But before, I used to do it under a sole prop, gotcha, a sole proprietorship.
Yep.
And what I would do is I had a personal account. Mm-hmm. And every time I would make money or take it out, I get taxed 40%.
Yeah.
40%
gains tax.
It's 38% capital gains tax, buddy, bro. It's a lot of money.
Yep.
So the problem with that is that like every time I pay my taxes, I can't really report it as income because they say, like, I went to go apply for a house. I did this like 1 year ago. And I said, yeah, I have all this money in my trading account. And I gave them the papers and they said, he's like, sir, you have no income. And I was like, what do you mean? Mm-hmm. And then she was like, oh, the money that you're making from your personal investment account is considered an investment. Yeah. It's not considered income. So like that's I was like, wow. I was like, bro, I should have known that when I first started.
Yeah.
So like
they don't tell you that.
They don't tell you that, bro. That sent me back so far back. So now I like what I told you guys before. I basically started an LLC and I pay myself through the LLC as an employee of my LLC.
And so what he means as an employee is you get that W-2, and that's what the lender's looking for. Because W-2 means that you are an employee of a company.
Yeah.
And the hack that what he's saying, so listen up. The hack that he's saying is that he created his own LLC and he's paying himself as an employee or from his own LLC to get his monthly income, that W-2. This allows him to branch out to get different loans, including the FHA and other conventional loans that you wouldn't normally be able to, you wouldn't normally be able to qualify for.
Yeah. That's the thing. But I wouldn't say I'm up there yet. Like now I can only like strategically take out $3,000 to $5,000 a month. I mean, which is like decent, right?
It's reasonable.
It's reasonable. But like, I want to get to like 10K, 20K, 30K a month.
And you will.
So I could, yeah, bro, I know. So I could get those like bigger properties, you know? Because I know with like 10K a month, you can get, I think like a $500,000 to $600,000 property, obviously with enough money down. But you know, like that's the goal. But you know, it just makes me realize that like the more you get into this, the more you realize you need a lot of cash if you want to buy a lot of things. You know what I mean?
True.
And if you want to buy one property, probably like 10 grand. I mean, yeah, maybe like 10 to 12 grand. And then if you want to go and buy multifamily properties, you want to start investing, you need a lot more cash than just $100,000. Because if your trading account goes up to like $100,000, $200,000, I'm gonna tell you right now, that ain't shit. Like, and if that's your only source of income, it ain't shit, bro. Like, so that's what I realized in this past year, is that $120,000 in your trading account is almost nothing, because like 80% of that money you need it anyways to day trade.
Exactly. So. And so now when it comes into real estate investing,
investing cash
you need regardless, right? Now if you want to do everything yourself, you need a bunch of cash and you need capital and loans, all that you can get. The two different people that I look for that I follow is, you know, Dave Ramsey. He says
Dave Ramsey,
don't use credit is bad. Makes sense. However, I listen more to Robert Kiyosaki, Rich Dad Poor Dad's author.
Abuse credit.
Basically, use other people's money to make them. So basically, use other people's money for you. So if you are trying to get into real estate investing and you want to start and you don't know where to start out, I would recommend going to networking and going to investor meetups. A great way to connect would be
how do we find these investor meetups, connections?
Right.
Like, how do we find? I'm a regular guy. I want to go and network with these people. How do I do it?
Good question. So, when you're looking to invest, go and find the people that do it. Now, where are they? They're everywhere. But specifically, where are they? Look up meetup.com. That's a great way to find local people that are interested in investment groups. Look up Eventbrite. You can find your local RIAs. REIA's Real Estate Investment Association.
It's free. Yeah.
Houston has the biggest one, and it's free. The first one is free. Usually they have some monthly payments, but it's all beneficial. These are some local spots and local websites that you can look up in order for you to go into those investor meetups. Now, what do you do when you're there? Introduce yourself. Have a smile. Be professional. Dress up clean. Wear a suit if you have one. If not, dress up with a good sweater and a good khakis, good shoes. Dress up professional, look clean, have a great smile, have a good energy, and have some business cards too. Or I have this little card that's called a dot card, and tap. Basically it taps on your phone and it pops up your whole contact, and they can save your contact. So these are different tips and tricks. In order for you to get that networking and get those connections when you're talking with those people.
That's what I'm saying, bro. For me, I like that concept. Like, the first networking event I went to was actually RIA.
Yep.
The very, very first one I went to, and it was in a Hilton in downtown. And very like, bro, let's get active. You know, like, I was excited. Yeah. I was very excited. But you know, the thing is like, what I like to say is that have a purpose in life, because if you don't have a purpose, you'll burn out eventually. Like, you'll be doing all this shit, and then like at the end you'll achieve what you really wanted, and then you'll be like, all right, bro, like, what's the point? Like, if this is not how I expected it to be, like, you know, so like, that's why I think like purpose is very important, you know?
Yeah. And for my purpose, the reason why I'm real estate investing and, so for my purpose is everything for the glory of God. I'm Christian, he's Muslim, and we still worship a higher power in the sense of following our purpose through our creator.
Yeah.
And for me, I feel like everything that I do is for him and for his glory. Mm-hmm. All his praise. He provides everything. And my ultimate goal is to make enough money to provide for my family, to be wealthy, but also to donate and give to charity, but mostly to focus on missions and helping the church, the local church, provide, because they have those connections in order to reach the entire world. Because everybody needs, you know, a higher power. Everybody needs, you know, basic necessities. I recently went on a mission trip in Mexico with my local church, and we worked with Living Waters. They are a mission group that helps all throughout the world with building wells and connecting wells. And so their mission is to provide water as well as the spiritual water of God. And so my ultimate purpose is, you know, spread the word, but also to help those who are in need. And so that's my everyday grind.
Wow,
I try to do it. And it's not easy being an entrepreneur, especially after you're trading.
Oh, yeah. It's a little tough.
Every day we're out
there
and grinding and studying.
It's not easy, bro. Yeah.
And if you're going to be an entrepreneur, you got to understand that you might have to start out with a part-time job to get that monthly income in order for you to start with that the trading.
Eventually,
for you to start with the e-commerce or even real estate. From my personal experience, they say have enough savings in your account for six months to a year. Why 6 months to a year? Because you don't make that much money in real estate starting off. If you do, amazing. Great for you. I wish you all the best. But it's your first year. You're building that clientele. You're learning the legal works, the contracts, how to develop the customer service, get in contact, marketing, social media, advertising. And so when you're going into real estate, understand that you want to have that savings. Now, if you go into investing, it's the same thing. Use the money that you have from your job, put it into your savings, find those connections, and work, start from there.
But there you go.
Have some money coming in.
I like to put entrepreneurship as a never-ending roller coaster. You know, like the roller coaster might get a little higher towards the end, but you'll still, even when you're up there making a lot of money, you'll still fucking come down, you know, and you'll get fucked up because, like, a lot of things will come up and, you know, life is not perfect. There's always going to be problems.
Right.
And even when I had problems back then, my problems were like, oh, I didn't have enough money to do this. But now I have bigger problems, you know. More money, more problems is really a thing. But on the other hand, more money, more solutions.
More solutions.
So I think that, so I think that like the problems I have now are way better than the problems I had before. You know, like I'm cool with having the problems I do right now than before. Like, oh, my car has a flat tire and the mechanic is taking too long. Like, dude, I don't care. I can still pay for it. You know, we're good.
Exactly.
So at the end of the day, it's more so of like having a high conviction of going at it and being prepared to make it through for like 6 months, like you said, and having the cash to do that. So the top two things you need when you're out there networking is your first impression, appearance, confidence, and knowledge, right? Just not crazy knowledge, but a little bit of knowledge.
Right. Yeah.
So appearance, you gotta look good, right? Be presentable. Make sure that you're not dressed like a bum on the side of the road. You know, like you want to look good.
Right.
You feel me? Number two is your confidence. You don't want to come up to somebody like, hey, like you want something from them. No, I want to come to you as like a friend, like, hey, bro, how's it going? Is your day going good? You know, like you don't want to come to them as like you're asking them for something, like a beggar, you know?
Because
you
want to see right through that.
They can easily, bro.
And they
easily
can also see when you're genuine too. So
yeah,
if you have that genuine interest to say, hey, how you doing, and get to know that person.
Yeah.
Connections.
Like you're just curious. You're good, bro.
Connection.
So be genuine and be confident. And then the third thing, knowledge. Make sure that you know a little bit about almost everything. Like if I'm going to like a real estate event, right, I got to make sure I know a little bit about what kind of loans there are, what are their daily tasks, what do real estate agents do. They're probably cold calling, so I'll crack a joke about cold calling, and that way I'm building the connection, you know. So like knowing a little bit of knowledge about almost whatever you're going to, wherever you're networking, right? So even if it's for like business, go and research some top 10 facts about business, whatever.
I would also like to add the knowledge part. know what next steps you want to take. So when people ask you, okay, what are you here for? I'm learning to invest. Oh, okay, what do you want to do in investing? Oh, I don't know. Wrong. I want to learn how to invest in multi-property. Wrong. Multifamily. I want to learn how to invest in multifamily properties, duplexes, fourplexes, triplexes, all of those.
Easily,
you know, commercial property, residential, things like that.
I forgot to ask you, bro. What about the VA loan? Tell me real quick, because we got to jump to the next topic, last topic. Real quick, what's a VA loan, and how am I qualified to get one, and how much time do I have to serve to actually use a VA loan?
Gotcha. So a VA loan is for our military members. No matter the time that you've served, you are qualified for a VA loan. How does that make sense? It's because you, even though you served for maybe a year compared to 20 years, there's a percentage of money is given to you from the government due to your service time, and that is how you're able to get a VA loan. So a VA loan basically is for military members. Depending on if you served 1 year to 20 years, you are given a percentage by the government through a VA loan and through your qualification. It's called a QI, or
a basic introduction to what a VA loan is.
So answering your question, what you need is your CE, Certification of Eligibility.
Okay.
This allows you to go to your lenders. Yeah. It proves that you were a military member.
Yeah.
And it also says how much service time that you had and how much you were allowed from the government to get the quantity of the loan.
Yeah.
That's the basic of it.
You get that from where? Oh, from the military, right?
From the lenders.
Oh, because
the government pays the
Makes
the lenders.
Sense. All right, cool. Makes sense. And how's your time doing right now in real estate? Like, have you closed any deals yet, or still?
So, yes. So I have worked with two clients right now.
Yeah.
I got them into an apartment. Right now I have two listings. I have one in Fifth Ward. A lot of construction's happening in Fifth Ward. We should see that, you know, growing soon, hopefully.
So that's gentrification.
Yes, gentrification.
At its finest.
Big word.
Bro, I've seen that happen so much. There's a place in Galleria. If you go to Galleria, drive to the houses right across, like around that area in the neighborhood, bro. I see a bunch of small houses, like one story small, and then next to it you see a humongous
three story
beautiful house, bro.
And Independence Heights, there's a lot in Independence Heights. And then North Houston, there's a lot. Yeah.
North Houston.
Yeah.
Like the Heights area.
Yeah, and it's called specifically the Independence Heights.
I'm gonna check that out, bro. What I like about those three story properties is that people like to Airbnb them.
Yep.
Because I mean, who wouldn't want a three story house with three different settings, you know what I mean?
Yep.
In one house, you know, like, and in Houston, there's not like mountains or beaches. So that's kind of the attraction here, is like nice properties or different styles, you know, that kind of thing.
Gotcha.
So I already asked you about your investing, business, your real estate success.
Networking.
The last thing I want to cover is what advice would you give to other entrepreneurs out there that are trying to like start, bro? That are just trying to like get their feet off the ground, because you know, now that you're making money, right? Like you're generating some kind of revenue, which is good, which is very hard for people to like to start doing. Because, you know, even when I started, bro, I was like 2 years to get first like make some kind of money, you know?
Oh, yeah.
Because the first thing I did was drop shipping. Like that was the first, before I got into trading. I was doing that for a little bit. I had my trading on the side. My trading, I was blowing accounts. Like, I was blowing accounts for 2 years. And then I tried out dropshipping. I paid a mentor. I was like, you know what, I'll do it. And really cool guy. I can't really mention his name because he's like retired, bro. Now he's old.
Gotcha.
But yeah, he helped me pretty much make my first, like, 10 grand. Online, like through Shopify.
Awesome.
It was 10 grand in 2 months, so I'll just say 5 grand a month, right? Because I made 5 grand the first month with the first product, and the second set of products, you know, 5k. But yeah, I made 10 grand with that account. But before that, bro, I didn't believe that I could actually make money online. I was like, this is bullshit.
Yeah.
Like, I took it as a joke. I was like, you know what? I'm gonna go full force and I'm gonna do it like it's a assignment at school, like an essay that I have to do anyway.
Mm-hmm.
So I forced myself to do it. The money is a byproduct of winning, you know, like,
yeah,
so like it just kind of came, the sales started coming. I was like, oh shit. And I mean, obviously I split some profits with my mentor because he was right next to me. So, and then the rest of that I kept. And that was my first like 10K in 2 months that I made, which was like insane for me because I was young. I was like 18. So tell me for you, bro, like, what was the first, like, good amount of money you made? You don't have to say the exact number, but, like, what pretty much led you to get there? And when you got there, did you have a firm belief that you can make more?
Okay, so right now, I'm a real estate agent. And for me, I've made decent amount of money as a real estate agent. They say it takes 6 months to a year before you start making some real bread in real estate. So, yeah. So for all those who are learning to, or for all those that are wanting to be an agent, have 6 months to a year in your savings account. When starting out, and my advice to all the entrepreneurs, it starts with a mentality. Mm-hmm. So you could start with something, you burn out, you don't like it, you're bored, you jump off to something else, right? So I would recommend, I would recommend some books in order for you to switch that mentality. Start changing your view towards money. What do I mean by that? Start making money work for you. Start trying to find different ways of, try to find different streams of income that are active and passive. The definition of active income is money that you work for in order to make that. And passive income is money that you can be sitting down talking to you right now and I'm getting money coming to my pocket. That can be from online businesses. It can be from trading. It can be from different entrepreneur strategies.
And the last one is residual income, right? Residual.
Residual. I don't know this one. Tell me.
I've heard about residual. Residual income, bro. That's like, okay, a passive income. That's, you still kind of got to do some work to maintain your business, right? Because you have passively, you're earning income passively, meaning that you're still doing some work to keep that thing going, right? Residual income is the highest level of income. Pretty much what it is you're earning money without doing absolutely nothing. Not even checking on it, not even making a call about it, nothing at all.
Got you.
And how do you do this? For example, I'll give you an example. Having royalties in a company to where they're generating income by themselves and you're getting a percentage of that, right? Yeah. Or owning a company that manages gas stations, for example, and you take 30% of the profits that that all those gas stations make because you are a initial investor.
Gotcha. So
residual income can be made.
That's in the long run.
Through investing. Yeah, it's in the long run, but it's also in the short run. Because that's the thing. People, like, they think that, okay, I'm going to start later on. But in reality, you can start now. Mm-hmm. You can. There's places where you can earn residual income through, like, small businesses. And all you have to invest is maybe, like, 50 grand. And it's not that much, bro. It's, like, it's a ball in the park. So residual income is the ultimate goal. Yes. But passive and active income is what you want to kind of build up right now.
Right now, right.
Before you get there.
Yeah.
So that's pretty much it. I think I don't have any more questions for you.
I think the only thing that I want to wrap up is trying to tell people different ways of investing.
Yeah.
The last tips I would say is research these next investment strategies. Yeah. Foreclosed properties.
Yeah.
Subject to properties.
Okay.
Section 8 properties.
Okay.
Multifamily properties, including duplexes, fourplexes, triplexes.
Yeah.
Commercial properties, strip malls, apartment complexes, office buildings, those all are commercial properties. Short sales, rehab, flips, buy and holds, Airbnb. There's multiple ways of making money in real estate, and those are just a little bit. I'm sure there's a lot more that I can't remember off the top of my head.
Yeah. No, but
if you're interested, there's multiple ways for you to invest, and just research those.
Bro, me and him, we're out there. We're about to go get it.
Yeah.
And the real estate market's about to take a little dump. I don't know if it's going to be big or small, but it's going to take a dump because we already see it in the car market. Cars are already... But me and him, we're out here getting the fucking bag. So, I mean, we're just trying to tell y'all what to do next. He's telling you to research these properties, right? What do you do? Go and research and find it. I'm going to do it myself, too. I'm going to research because generally, I actually want to learn it because I'm curious. But me in the stock market, I see that interest rates are getting higher and higher. And according to history, when interest rates raise above 5-6%, shit starts to
hit the fan.
There you know what I mean? So like that, and when shit hits the fan, what comes up?
Opportunities.
Yes, there you go. So opportunities, bro, is what me and him, and I hope all of you are going to take as well because shit, I'm trying to make some money. You're trying to make some money. Shit, so.
Trying to be wealthy.
Yeah. So, let me know what you guys think.
Awesome. Well, thank you so much, Ubaidi. Yes, I appreciate it for everything.
Yes, sir.